serve a great and mighty God. Amen. Amen. He is faithful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. No matter what's going on, you know, when we're not faithful, He still is, and He's still worthy of all praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Lord, we just worship you. We invite your sweet Holy Spirit in this place today. Come on, let's just ask you this morning, Holy Spirit, come. We desire you. We need you this morning, and we invite you here today. Help us to set our hearts and our minds on you, that we seek after you this morning, that we press into your presence, and not let this time go by, God. We give you all praise for what you're doing in our lives and in our church. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Your name is great. We're not ashamed to say it. Your name is great. We'll shout it out.
Oh, merciful Savior. And we worship you this morning because you are worthy, 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 worthy. God, we set our minds on you, Lord. Lord, we come against every hindrance and everything that would try to take us away from you, Lord. Anything, God, that distracts, Lord, is just a tool that the devil wants to use to pull us away from his presence. And he's a liar. He's a destroyer. He's the one who always tries to tear down what you want to do. We're not going to give him any place, not in our hearts, not in our minds, not in this church. Devil, you're a liar. And we believe God and what he said, who we are in him, and he is worthy. Amen? Come on, let's focus on him this morning. Lord, all because of you, Jesus. Lord, our faith in you. Your grace comes to us, and we worship you and enter into your presence this morning by faith. Hallelujah. Come on, let's just open our mouths and worship him. Let's raise our hands. Let's use everything we have that is in us to give him glory and honor because he is worthy. Lord, we worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, tell him I love you, Jesus. Oh, God, I desire your presence. Hallelujah, Lord. You're such a good God, so merciful, Lord, hallelujah. I glorify your name, praise your name, worthy are you, Lord, merciful Savior, hallelujah. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer.
You are the one that we pray. Paratoko sekeperea tandetea su, lekia, barutu tutuiatea papa, e kikiki atando do siki, paratu, be korotun kabasa, baratande te kurata, natature, bebea, kuretande, roto.
Draw nigh unto me, saith the Lord, accept my embrace. For I say to you that in my embrace and in my love, the storms of life will not knock you off your feet, saith the Lord. For I will be your strength, I will be your song, I will be your joy, I will be your hope. Behold, I say unto you that in this world there will be tribulations. But if you draw unto me and come into my embrace, saith the Lord, behold, I say to you that those days will not be difficult for you, and the trials will not overcome you, saith the Lord. For I am enough. In me you will find all you have need of, saith the Lord. For I am your all in all. I just wanna speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. Cause I know that there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Stand up for singing, Jesus. Oh, I just want
It could be a physical healing, it could be emotional healing. I want you just to step up front as we sing that song. And we're not going to embarrass you, we're not going to ask you anything, but we're just going to believe God together. Because, you know, he is our healer. Yes. And, you know, the same one that took the stripes on his back, the Word of God says that he tells the number of the stars, and he calls them all by their name. And then the last part of that verse says he heals a broken heart. So, you know, he can heal a broken heart. He can heal broken bones. He's done it for me before. He can heal cancer. And we're praying for Lynn and different ones. But I want you to know our God is a healer. And the healer is in the house today. And let's believe together. I feel the Spirit of God moving in just a powerful way. We've been feeling that for the last month or so. I'm talking about in an extra strong way. And you know, let's just believe the Lord together. We're going to sing it. We're going to sing it again. And let's just sing all three of these verses, 1, 2, and 3. I love this song, but let's ask the healer to touch us today in this place. And you know, again, expect miracles. Believe God for big and mighty things. You know, don't limit God. He said, if you ask anything in my name, I'll do it. And let's just believe him together because he has the power. And he's got the name that's above every name, the name of Jesus above every name in heaven, the Word of God said, and above every name on this earth, and even above every name in the pits of hell. That name of Jesus is above every name. That's why demons tremble when they hear that name of Jesus. And you know, you say Buddha, it don't do nothing. You say Jesus, and you feel something. So let's just believe him together. And I certainly don't mind if some of you believers want to just come up and lay a hand on him somewhere in an appropriate place and pray a prayer of faith. And let's just believe God right now. Because the Word of God in Mark 16 says believers can lay hands on sick and they shall recover. So if somebody just needs a healer, whether they're sick or whether they're diseased, no, ain't no matter what it is, or whether it's emotional or it's a broken heart, let me tell you something, the Lord can heal today. And we're going to believe him to do that. Thank you for coming to help us right now. Let's sing it together. Jesus, your name is power. Oh, Jesus, your name is mine. Oh, yes. Jesus, your name will break every stronghold. Oh, you believe it? Jesus, your name. Number 2 again, his name is healing. praise, give him glory, give him honor. You know, we were in Matthew chapter 24 before, and let me just kind of go back in case you were not here. You can go back and read Matthew chapter 24. I'm not going to put that up on the screen, Autumn, but I am gonna put 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, verses 1 through 5, so you can be ready for me on that. 2 Timothy, 3rd chapter, verses 1 through 5. But, you know, Jesus, when the disciples come up, said, what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the world? And the first thing Jesus said, he didn't say, keep your eye on Israel. Now, he's already talked about keep your eye on the fig tree when it began to bud and all, you know, summer's nigh and all that. And he was talking about the nation of Israel. And, of course, the fig tree's been budding for years. The fig tree's been budding. They planted back in their land in 1948. And I believe it's Hosea says that they'll never be plucked out of their land again. You know, isn't it amazing, that little old bitty strip that everybody's fighting over? You know, God is in control. I mean, he's going to have last word, but he's also going to put his hand down or his finger in on stuff, business affairs and what have you, world affairs, even right now. But you know, the main deal, I mean, Jesus answered with not even stutter. He just said, take heed now. And I believe we all ought to take heed. We ought to continue to take heed. We ought to be, you know, we ought to be, like it says, wise as serpents and harmless as doves or whatever. But we ought to be on guard. We ought to be sober. We ought to be vigilant. According to Paul, put a lot of writings out. You can come up with several different sayings there. But Jesus said, take heed. What do we take heed for? He said, that no man, And I honestly, please know, I don't believe there's no gender involved there. It don't matter. No person deceive you. That means from the pulpit to the pew to the White House, wherever, let no man deceive you. And I've never seen the like of deception, you know, that's in our, that I've never seen deception like it is, okay, today. I've never seen, and you know, we used to say there's a hidden agenda. How many of y'all understand that? You know, hidden agenda, they're trying to get this done. They're trying to get prayer out of school. They're trying to get the Bibles, take the Bibles away. They're trying to, well, they're not, it's not hidden any longer what they're trying to do. Now they're not only trying, they are doing it. They're teaching kids. They're even helping kids and things that the family ought to be involved with. It ought to be authorized by family, by moms and dads and stuff. They're promoting things. A long time ago, they started out, seriously, I know that some of you probably do know this or don't know it. I've said it before, but it's been a long time. I mean, right here, even at Natchitoches Central years ago, they were teaching kids to how to put a condom on a banana and then making condoms available because the kids might need them over the weekend. Let me tell you something. I didn't want my daughters knowing how to put a condom on a banana. I didn't want my daughters, you know, taking a handful of them because they might need them. You know why? Because the Word of God says the bed is undefiled in marriage. And we taught and raised and taught to our kids and trained our kids and tried to in the church that you wait. Now, do I think that all the kids are going to wait? Am I trying to make anybody feel bad that has gone ahead and been loose with that or went ahead and failed in the flesh? Or I'm not standing up here unaware that most of, but let me just go ahead and say something. There, you know what I think is great? When they talk about all these people have these powerful testimonies of how God delivered them, you know what I think is a greater testimony? For a kid to say that I have never done drugs, that I have never gone to bed with a girl or a boy, whatever, and when I got married, I was a virgin. There's nothing wrong with being a virgin, and there are still some in the United States of America and in a lot of churches. Now, if you were not, we're not going to get you to stand up here and say if you was or wasn't, it don't matter, and some of you would turn red, and another thing, it ain't none of our business, and I do want you to know, even if you blew it, if you messed up, thank God for the blood of Jesus. Thank God for the blood of Jesus. And we're to love people. We're to operate in mercy and love and forgiveness. We're not to hold things against people. But let me just say, I'm proud of the young people that keep themselves. Amen. And we got a lot of them that do. You know, so praise God for that. And another thing, I want to warn you, it's like, let me just go ahead and throw out a little warning. One thing, you know, some of y'all may be offended. I mean, I really, when I say I don't care if you're offended, but what I'm saying, I'm not going to back up on my stand the way I feel. I am a teetotaler, okay? If you're one of them sipping saints, it's your business. But if you sip a saint too much, I know what I said. If you saint gets a sipping too much and you get kind of totsy or whatever you call it, you get kind of, you know, you get kind of giggly and silly and giggly and goofy feeling and all that. I've seen them. I've been around them. I've seen them slobbering, burp, and run down. And if you, next thing you know, if you get drunken, let me just go ahead and say something. You know, sure, God will forgive you. And I know Paul said a little wine for the stomach's sake. But I don't know if it's fermenting. You don't know neither, really. You really don't. Because they got some real strong grape juice that's not fermented. But let me just say, even if it was, but let me just say this. Did you know the Bible talks about no drunkard will inherit the kingdom of God? And if you get drunk and the Lord comes, I'm going to be honest with you. I'll be kind of scared for you. Amen. If you're there drunk. And the trumpet sound, you know, what was that, honey? I'm sorry, Jerry. You know, I'd rather be a teetotaler and be on the safe side, and because my Bible tells me, there you read it in Proverbs, don't look on it when it moves itself aright in the cup. Now, y'all know what when it moves itself aright in the cup means? It's fermentation. So that's why people go to Majo's and get in a brown bag. Take the top off a Papa Top, and they don't look at it because it's in the brown bag. So they won't look at it, and they go ahead and chug a lug. How many of y'all really be on the safe side? I can do without some things, can't y'all? I can do without some things. And when I read the part where Jesus said, few there be that find it. You know, few there be that find it. Also, let me just tell you something. I'll just go ahead and tell you something about beer. My brother used to work at a brewery, the one that died early from drinking, one of them. He used to work at a brewery, and you know what his job was? Big old wooden vats, big old huge wooden vats. I had to pick him up one time, I believe, and I saw kind of, I didn't see it, all the detail. His job every morning was to go up there and get on a catwalk around the top and dip off in a net, dead, big old seed rats, we called them, about this long there, eating that fermented, all that real gusto. That real gusto was in there. That's why you got real gusto in it. You got rat this and rat that and rat and dead rats and vomiting rats. Real gusto. That's like that Marlboro guy smoking. Now, I'm not against smoking. That's, you know, it won't send you to hell. Just make you smell like you've been there. But they get this dude sitting there, real good square jaw fella. Boy, looks like a rifleman or something, sitting up there in a cowboy hat. And he's on his horse, and he's behind 2,000 or 3,000 head of cattle. And they say, come to where the flavor is. Have you ever been around a bunch of cattle? They're messing up our climate. They put patties on the ground. And they'll dry and you can make paperweights out of them, put a little bumblebee on them. And, you know, let me tell you something. There, boy, don't the devil use advertising to deceive people? Amen. You know, and why don't they, when they're advertising their beer and their whiskey, why don't they show a man that done beat his family or raped his family or wrecked a car and he's laying there over in the ditch all cut up because he's so drunk, intoxicated, he couldn't hold a car on the road, or he hit another car head on when he got and killed a family with a bunch of beautiful children in there that was trying to mind their own business and do their own thing, you know? So let me just say though, but I'm a teetotaler, okay? And if you're not, I still love you and I thank the Lord for you. But let me tell you something, pray about it, you know? Ask the Holy Spirit to quicken your heart. You know, I know a lot of people say, well, I just drink one every now and then. I just do. Well, that's your business, that's fine. You know, I drink some tea every now and then. And every now and then I break down and drink a Coke. So I drink stuff besides water too sometimes. But I had no Kool-Aid in years. But at least I don't get drunk on it. I don't get intoxicated. I've never got out of my head, you know, on drugs or dope, nothing. I'm not better than anybody else. My heart goes out to people that are addicts, that are addictive to things and all. I mean, even sometimes over-the-counter prescription drugs can get people hooked and get people mess them up sometimes. It's like with the drug situation, my heart goes out. I do say, though, keep praying, keep believing God, because God is a God that can bring deliverance and healing of any kind. You know, I wish I had time for Perry to give part of his testimony right now, but I mean, the Lord, he's a living testimony how God can set you free. God can set you free, and many of you are. So thank the Lord for that. But I didn't mean to get on that, but let me just say, deception is on every hand, and it honestly breaks my heart. When I think about the agenda that's going on that they're trying to push to mess our kids up, and even behind parents' backs. I think a lot of y'all are aware of that, aren't you? And then when they tell a kid, it's okay to these feelings you got. Maybe these feelings you got, maybe you're really a boy in a girl's body. Or maybe you're really a girl in a boy's body. And then we got some up in Washington now in some top leadership positions, some of them, and they say they're a woman. They're about the ugliest woman I've ever seen in my life, though. I can tell the difference. How many of you know the Bible says the countenance doth witness against them? They're, you know, and deception's on every hand. They're trying to say that's okay. But how many of you want to look and, I mean, I'm not going there, but how many of you for yourself personally want to look and see what God has to say on the subject, and then whatever God says, you'll, you know, I like what some folks say. If God say the same, then I'll do this and I'll do that. Whatever God says, I'm gonna go with. How about you? Amen. Amen. So take heed. Don't get deceived, because it's not, you know, these guys that want to be a woman, you can tell they're a guy. You can see and tell. The bone structure different, the muscles different. The DNA is different, and it'll prove, and I will tell you this, they're coming out now. I just saw them this week. One of the senators questioned somebody else that was presenting, trying to get funds for men for abortion now, getting abortion money for a man that thinks he's a woman, and he can't have no abortion because he can't have no baby, because he's still a he. He is not a she. I'm getting confused. I'm going to start saying, well, I better shut up. I was going to start saying shims. She, him, because they, forget it. But, you know, they start trying to, I can't understand. We need to pray like never before. How many of y'all believe that? Well, I can't understand some senators and congressmen and women. I can't understand them sitting there. And just acting like, well, that's just normal, or that's okay, or they got a right to push that. Not if it's wrong, we don't have a right to push it. I don't think we ought to be giving our jets away neither, not to nobody except Israel, if they don't need them. You know, I just... It's unreal, the deception that's in the land. And how many of y'all, seriously, how many of y'all could lift a hand and say that you've been concerned too, but you're aware of some of the deception that's going on, and I ain't even scratched the surface. I mean, there's people trying to, being deceived and trying to be deceived, and people trying to deceive all over the place. Now, Timothy, if you would, put that up there, Timothy, the second chapter. Verse 1 through 5. And this says, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. How many of you believe we're in the last days? Yes. Perilous times shall come. Go ahead. That men will be lovers of their own self, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, and unthankful and unholy. And oh me, without natural affection. And if you don't understand that this is, you know, concerning like the LGBT or homosexuality and stuff, then I'm sorry. You need to get you some kind of concordance and go checking it out in the Greek, Hebrew, whatever, and look and see what this is saying if you don't understand what it's saying. I think most of you do. But they're without natural affection. You know, it's not natural. It's not natural for men to desire men. Romans, the first chapter, talks about that. I wish we had more time this morning. It's not a natural thing. And leave the natural use of the woman and burn toward lust and love or whatever for sexual pleasures and whatever toward another man. It's not natural. That's what the Word of God says. Y'all understand that? If you don't, read Romans, the first chapter. Without natural affection, and then truth breakers. How many people are breaking their word, and false accusers? There's people, I mean, it's unreal how much people are getting falsely accused. And I'm gonna go ahead and say, I know they won't like this just cause some terminology, but you know, a lot of the stuff, and if y'all don't know it, you could probably go on YouTube and watch. You could watch Tucker Carlson, whether you like him or not, you could watch there and see some of these films that's been released to him on the what they call the insurrection on the White House on January the 6th, and you'll find out that how many lies were being told about on the Capitol. Excuse me, I said White House, but on the Capitol, and you can see the actual film footage. Over 40,000 hours of film had got released to him by the Speaker of the House now, and so they've delved into that look, and they're showing it. And I know they're hated. I guarantee they're hated. But it's not a conspiracy theory, it's facts. You can see it, and you can have, he talked to people even that would tell the truth of, as to what happened. So people are false accusers. People are putting a false, just all kind of deceit going out, okay? And I think above all that we need to pray and ask God to help us not be deceived. And all, and I don't know who wouldn't want the truth anyway, you know, of whatever. But despisers of those that are good, and you know, it's a shame sometimes. It's a shame sometimes when certain people can get punished, and then other people that do stuff a whole lot deeper and more so just go scot-free, you know, just because of who their name is. So, you know, we got deception on every hand in this land, and I'm telling you, I'm gonna say it one more time. It really breaks my heart. Sometimes I see American flag, and I just bawl. You know, and not just cause I was in the military neither, and not just cause I went to war zone, but I just bawl for America, and I ask God to touch us, and to heal our land, and I wish I had time to mention some of these other things in Matthew 24, but it talked about wars and rumors of wars and earthquakes and all this, and I don't have time. And be hated of all nations, the children of Israel, the Jews will be hated of all nations. And Jesus even said for us, marvel not if they hate you, the world hates you because it hated me first. So sure, we're going to be hated and despised for being children of God. So some of it just comes with the territory, like we say sometime. If you're a Christian and you're standing up for what's right, sure, some people are going to talk about you and criticize you. But guess what? It's like Francis mentioned, our good friend Dave Reaver said a long time ago. He said if he had time just before the rapture takes place, how many of y'all know that that's going to happen one of these days? And we're going to be out of here. That's why Luke 21:36 says, pray that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things which shall come to pass and stand before the Son of Man. He said he wished he had time just before the rapture was going to take place. The Lord let him know, pull his shoes off and write Turkey on the bottom of them. So when he's going up, that people can read it, Turkey. You know, he's calling them a turkey because they didn't believe and they wasn't ready to go when the Lord comes. But how many of y'all do believe that the Lord's going to come, and we're living in the day and age? So when I say it, it saddens me. I'm happy about we're going to be the dispensation. I honestly believe with all my heart we're going to be the ones alive and remain to the coming of the Lord, because signs of the time are sizing up so fast and so quickly that the coming of the Lord is near. I really honestly believe it's near. So I want to encourage all of you to pray and believe God, and if there's things that you know, how many of you understand what I say when I say clean your life up? You know, was it Jeremiah or Psalmist David? But anyway, said, see if there be any wicked way in me. Yeah, David. And then Jeremiah taught the heart. Who can know it? No, well, see, God knows it. And if we'll humble ourselves before the Lord and say, God, you know, help me. If I need to cut some cords, if I need to cut some things out of my life, my lifestyle or whatever it is, no matter what it is, and I'm not just talking about drinking or whatever now, but I'm saying whatever it is, if there's something we're doing that displeases the Lord, or something that, you know, is going to hinder us, or something that's going to make us be left behind. You know, a lot of people just think no matter what's going to, God's just going to take everybody. No, he said few there be that find it. And he talked to us about keep ourselves unspotted from this old world. How many of you know if you rub shoulders with the world sometime, it can kind of get you dirty. It can kind of get you down. Has anybody, it's kind of like years ago, we were little, we'd get behind the cook stove in the country. And one time we had a wood cook stove. Of course, it's hot, you didn't get there too. You could feel that heat a long way off. But once it cooled down, or even the regular old stove, they had a vent pipe on it back there. And Mom would say, "You been back behind that stove again? You been playing back that stove?" "No, Mama." She knew I did, because I had soot all over me there where it come out that pipe. You know, and that's kind of how, if we don't watch out, we'll get to kind of enjoying stuff maybe that we shouldn't enjoy. I really, you know, and I'm not one of these clothesline preachers, please know that. How many of y'all know I'm not? I'm not saying this is sending you to hell, that is sending you to hell, you can't do this, you can't do that. I believe we ought to have fun. I believe we ought to have a good time. I believe we ought to go places and do things and laugh and have fun. And I don't think it's wrong to go to Branson. I don't think it's wrong to go to Six Flags. I don't think it's wrong to fish. I don't think it's wrong to hunt. I don't think it's wrong to ride four-wheelers and do things and camp out. I don't think that's wrong. But I'm saying, how many of you know that if you're really sincere with God, He can put a finger on stuff if you're really open toward Him? He can say, "God, please help me, and let me clean this up. Let me be ready to go at any cost. I don't need a bunch of stuff to hold me down." See, the Word of God talks about we got to watch it, lest the cares of this life and the deceitfulness of riches, He said, that day would come upon us unawares. So, you know, you got to not... We're in this world, but we're not of it. But anyway, getting back to this scripture, it says, "False accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good." And go ahead. "Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure, more than lovers of God." And it says, "Having a form of godliness, but denying their power thereof, from such turn away." Please know, there's nothing wrong with love and pleasure, okay? So I'm not saying that. But there is something wrong with love and pleasure more than we love God. And so don't let this world get such a hold on us that we get our eyes off of Jesus and get our eyes off of that expectancy that the Lord's going to come anytime. Now, I wish that clock would stop sometime. Oh, yeah. But you can't. Can you get everybody's phone so they can't read the time on it? Can I read one more scripture and I quit? Is that okay with you? I know everybody's got agendas and schedules and all that. But this is one that Jerry walked in on me and caught me. And it just touched me. It just touched me so much. If you would, turn to 2 Chronicles so everybody can see this. 2 Chronicles 20. And let's just do 3 through 9 real quick. 2 Chronicles 20, 3 through 9. And I won't preach every verse. Just some of them. No, I won't. Listen to this. "And Jehoshaphat, the king, he feared and set himself to seek the Lord." You know, I want to encourage everybody that it'd be good if we all did the same thing. We made our mind up to seek the Lord and proclaim a fast throughout all of Judah. You can fast too if you want to. I'm not trying to say let's do a fast also, but we need to ask the help of the Lord. It don't hurt to miss a meal every now and then. You know, you can tell by looking, I could miss a few. Okay, now, "And Judah gathered himself together to ask help of the Lord." Notice this terminology. The king wanted to seek the Lord, and they all, Judah, which I think means praise, you know, the definition there, but they gathered together and to ask help of the Lord. Everybody say, ask help. Go ahead. "Even the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. And Jehoshaphat stood in the congregation of Judah in Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court," go ahead, "and said, O Lord, God of our fathers, art thou not the God in heaven? and rules not over all the kingdoms of the heathen. Now, keep in mind, he's ruler over all the kingdoms, even of the heathen. And thine, in thy hand, is there not power and might, so that none is able to withstand thee? How many of you believe that? Whew! Amen. That's the God we serve. And are not thou our God, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and gave it to the seed of Abraham, thy friend, forever? Aren't you the same God? Listen to this. And they dwell therein, and have built thee a sanctuary therein for thy name, saying. Now listen to this. If when evil cometh upon us, and seriously, how many of y'all sense and feel that there's evil going on, even in America, in our land? If when evil, notice this, not if it comes, but is if when evil cometh, it's come now, it's on us, a lot of it, as the sword, or judgment, or even pestilence, or even famine. Now, if when this evil comes, he said, now watch this, if we stand before thee in this house and in thy presence, how many of y'all know now we don't have to go to a particular place, we don't have to go to a temple over in Drew, we are the temple of the Holy Ghost, amen? We are a temple of God right here. And if we stand in thy presence, we've got his presence, for thy name is in this house. How many of y'all have his name? Jesus. And cry unto thee in our affliction. Then will thou hear and help. When evil comes, if we stand in his presence and in his name, and his name's in us, and we cry unto him in our affliction, he will hear and help. And 2 Chronicles 7:14, and I've used it a lot, says, if my people, which are called by my name, how many of y'all called by his name, shall humble themselves and pray. See, take time to pray. Don't matter where or when, but pray and seek my face and turn, says there, but our wicked ways. My people, Jesus said, not the world, not the evil people, not Washington, not senators, congressmen, them too, but he's talking to us. My people will just stop, humble himself and pray. Seek his face, turn from the wicked ways. Then will I hear from heaven, and I'll forgive their sin. And oh, how I would love to see America heal again. And you know, I just closing, I'd like everybody to stand that can. If you can't, it's okay. Just sit down if you're hurting, because I definitely understand that sometimes you have to rest. And I started to ask everybody to come up here, but it's already now almost 12:15. And let's just take, it won't take long, let's just take about 2 minutes. And just have a little prayer time, whether you pray out loud or you pray silently, right where you're at. Humble yourself under the Lord, you are already. And say, God, you said, like Jehoshaphat, if I get in your temple, and I am your temple, you're here. If I'll seek your face and I'll ask for help, then it says we can hear from you. Chronicles says that we'll humble ourselves and pray and seek his face. Not some senator or representative or whatever, even though I think we ought to be involved with them as much as you can or whatever, but tell them what you think.
But for us, if we'll humble ourselves and pray and turn from our wicked ways, we'll repent. Say, God, help me to live like you want me to live. Do what you want me to do. Lord, help. Heal our land. I honestly believe with all my heart. I believe that revival can come where there's repentance and if people will repent. And I'm not just talking about y'all. I'm talking about all of us, but I'm talking about Christians in the world. If they'll humble themselves and repent, turn from their stuff that God's already dealt with them about, and get hungry for God, we can have revival just before Jesus comes. Now, he may come anytime. Please know I'm not trying to put that off, because I believe in the imminent return of the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe he'll come anytime. He may come before we get to go home, and that's fine. We'll be with him. But my heart breaks for America that I love so much, and for our children and our grandchildren to have to be subject to all this mess, all this evil. And he said, if evil comes, if we'll stand and pray and ask for help, he said, he hears. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, there's people praying. They've been praying. And Lord, 100 people praying 2 minutes, that's a lot of time. That's a lot of prayer. So Lord, just a few minutes in seeking your face and asking for help is a lot of petitioning right now from your people, whether they're praying out loud or praying silent. And Lord, we do repent. And Lord, we do ask that you even reveal stuff in us that, Lord, you're not pleased with, so we can change. And with your grace and with your Holy Spirit, we can change. We can. So, Lord, we want that. But Lord, we ask you for help. Lord, thank you for being present here, and thank you for being present in us. And we ask you for help, Lord. We've got kids, we've got children, we've got grandchildren that unless something happens, Lord, they're not going to make it. But Lord, we want them to make it. So Lord, we're asking for help. We're asking to save, Lord, our families. Save our children, our grandchildren, Lord. Save our nephews and our nieces, and save our brothers and our sisters, Lord God, that are part of these families represented here. Save them, Lord, before it's too late. Move on them through the power of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, help America, bless America. Lord, we know that deception is here, and we know that you said it would be, but you warned us, told us to be on guard and not be deceived. So help us, Lord, not to fall for deception, but help us to stand up for the truth. And we know the truth. We know you are truth. We know that it will set us free and make us free. And so, Lord, we just praise you for hearing the prayers that have been prayed in this place just these last few minutes. Thank you for being a God that not only hears us, but that answers prayer. Lord, I ask you to touch our people, Lord, and bless our people and keep our people, Lord. Lord, keep them protected, Lord. Keep them in the ark of safety, Lord God. Let the guardian angels encamp around about them, Lord God. And bless the things they put their hands to, Lord. Bless their finances, Lord. Bless their families. Bless their household. Bless their possessions, Lord God. Keep us, Lord, from the evil one. Lord, we love you, Lord. We thank you for being such a mighty God. And we praise you, Lord God, for your goodness and your mercy. And we ask you, Lord, to continue to let healing virtue flow to those that need a healing touch. Lord, you're better than any doctor, physician, or specialist in this land. You're better. You're greater. You made us. You know exactly what we need, Lord, individually. Lord, just put your hand upon us, we pray. Cover us, Lord, we pray. Lord, thank you for the peace that we feel. Thank you for the safety that we feel in you, Lord God. Thank you for your goodness and your mercy. Thank you for saying that goodness and mercy, as the psalmist David said, will follow us all the days of our life. And then he wound up with saying, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.